We have blood on our hands. The need, the desire, the impetus to draw the blood of our enemies in the name of ownership, belief, culture has left a stain which will take many generations to cleanse. For too long, we have failed to agree on what is right, what is just. Unable to demonstrate our enlightenment, we have relied on displays of power and military innovation in its stead. In our zeal to claim the high ground, geographical and moral, where we could not prove to our adversaries that we were right, we instead strove to prove that we were strong. Can be as powerful a show of strength as the utter annihilation of those who would seek to do us harm. If you are troubled by what you see here today, if you are left ill at ease by our failure to find a peaceful way to resolve any disputes, remember that those who pay with their lives are making a long overdue payment. Sacrifice to those who fell in inestimable numbers and in vain before this age of light. If you are enticed or exhilarated by the human cost of resolving our disputes, I would beseech you to remember instead the darkness which came before. For this need to find a resolution in a contained, controlled manner. We do not speak here of the issues to be resolved, but words that were have been spoken and fallen short. That we are here at all is testament that no discourse on this issue can be concluded in agreement. Instead, the agreement is of the terms of the struggle, after which both parties will honor those terms. The issue will be documented but never again debated, since no agreement can be reached, no compromise sufficient. We call upon the struggle to decide the doom of the participants.
an ex-Navy supply ship with minimal markings and no name, wars against an unassuming platform. Captain Osborne tentatively steps from the gangplank onto the structure, where he is met by two men in military boiler suits with no rank or insignia, and each holding a rifle. Both are clearly uncomfortable, and the captain wonders whether the source of their discomfort is his presence, the exposed nature of the platform, or the guns, which are clearly not the tools with which they are used to working. The ship does not exist officially. Along with most of those aboard, she is reported to have been lost to enemy mines in 1917, so it is apt that Osborne requested only a skeleton crew. Over the last 5 years, he has pieced together various resources, none of which are known to anyone but Alvaro and himself. The ship is one of his greatest assets, but there are none of which he is more proud than the platform. This is his first time here, but he knows its secrets, and it is with keen anticipation that he follows the Ability's engineers to the top of the carefully concealed lift shaft. Subject 17 worries at a patch of skin under his sleeve for a moment, then stops as suddenly as he started. The action suggests itching and irritation, though the face betrays no sign of discomfort. His hands fall limp once more by his sides. A moment later, there is nothing to suggest him having moved at all. Clarence glances at the plain schoolroom-style clock on the wall to his left, and notes the time in the green book alongside number 17's details, together with a brief description of what he has observed. Clarence neither knows nor cares the significance of this information, but knows that the data miners are insistent to the point of rudeness in their need for detail. When first he started at Fotopolis, he was decidedly uneasy around the subjects. He'd been told over and again in the training sessions that they are as cattle, substantially less aware even. They can respond to basic bodily impulses, but have no consciousness, no sentience. Paris remembers watching the training video and learning that the island's denizens are manufactured, grown in laboratories, and then kept here on Protopolis for study. They're fed, watered, and exercised. Their physical health monitored. The diet is uninspiring but balanced and served to them by a drip feed. Physically, they are doubtless healthier than the majority of true humans on the mainland. They have no vices, no desires, no ambitions. Save for the appearance and the carefully controlled and monitored bodily functions, they have little more in common with a true human than just a potato. As to the exact nature of the experiments, Clarence is not possessed of any driving curiosity, and moreover, he's fairly sure that the less he knows, the better. He is semi-consciously aware that ethically, the subjects reside in something of a grey area. Lab-grown human beings give scientists the opportunity to trial medicines, cosmetics, biological weapons, on subjects who are physiologically identical to the consumers and targets of the fully tested products, without having to test on animals, a process whose drawbacks have been twofold. The first is one of biology. Effects of a particular compound on a human could only be categorically concluded when tested on a human. While different species of animals have varied similarities to humans, none are exact. Different species are needed to get the closest match for the various areas of human physiology, meaning that the facility having available the closest matches to humans entails the keeping of a diverse menagerie, none of which is an absolute match. The second drawback was one of morality. The tendency of certain groups to put a value on the innocence and subsequent lack of choice of animals that outweighed in their minds the intrinsic value of their own species. The need to defend animals on the grounds that they are not equipped to defend themselves had led to campaigns in the forms of variously politics and sabotage, whose outcome was ultimately the banning of all animal testing. Coupled with the high risks of releasing an untested product to an increasingly litigious public, this resulted in a scenario where manufacturers had to either prepare to defend their products in courts of law, or find a rigorous and robust testing mechanism that did not necessitate animal testing. Clarence is aware that those of a more sensitive disposition than he might question the rights and wrongs of the testing on proto-humans, leading to endless debate and legal posturing, but he's paid handsomely enough to include a difference in his job description, and has never been served well by asking questions anyway. The subjects are not self-aware and are kept in good health. Save for the occasional unexplained disappearance of a specimen, they are more well looked after than most true humans. Clarence's post is far too mundane for him to ever be privy to knowledge about where the lost ones go. He speculates that they're moved to other locations, or harvested for organs, or maybe even stolen and sold as macabre sex toys on the black market. But the initial unease has long since faded into boredom and disinterest after watching them stand statuesque for months, save for the occasional tick or itch, so it no longer burdens his conscience. The operation is, by necessity, clandestine. Though this is with the intention of keeping it out of the public eye, not from those of the law, which as yet has no position on the rights or lack thereof of proto-humans. Protopolis is an island, large enough for employee lodgings and a few administration buildings, a canteen and some sparse recreational facilities, yet small enough so as not to attract attention. There is a small, mirrored glass building near the centre of the island, against a rock face. A building Clarence has never been inside, which from the number of people he sees going in, he has been forced to conclude is either disconcerting or claustrophobic, or continues under the island, the latter seeming to be the more likely. On the few occasions that he does give it any thought, Clarence supposes that this is where subjects are grown. The process used is something of a mystery, and the facilities even more so. No one outside the main proto-farm knows anything about how the proto-humans are grown. The island is not on any major shipping routes or flight paths, so the projects remain largely unmolested and unobserved. As for the strange appearance of what appear to be people, the tunics and shifts in which the subjects are clad are long and plain. Anyone seeing them would only register them as beasts of the field, or possibly monks if they happened close enough to recognise the humanoid form. The geographic location of Protopolis is such that the weather is never very varied. Too far north for any long exposure to the sun, too far south for anything as unpredictable as snow. A more or less constant drizzle leaves the island as blank in expression and as lacking in emotion as its inhabitants. The research is classified. Clarence's friends and family believe he still works on an oil rig, so even the wells, which have not yet been completely plundered, have long since dried up to the extent that only skeleton staff is ever needed to keep the rigs working. And so promotion to Protopolis is not unusual for a redundant rigger. This is not public knowledge, of course, but there's very little in the way of social connections, having spent most of his adult life on the rigs. Keeping secrets is not something which causes Clarence any sleepless nights. The pay is very good and the work awfully simple. Just watch the herd for 8 hours at a time, making a note of any and all behaviour which strays from the default of standing still. In the early days, the cold, vacant eyes had been what troubled Clarence. Faces completely human and so effortlessly familiar, but for the glazed over eyes and too relaxed jaw. Nobody home. No lights on him. Spending 8 hours a day watching them. So similar to people, yet missing anything which fundamentally would define them as such. The unease soon faded to boredom. What he had at first seen as sinister apparitions, he now just saw as fleshy automatons. No AI, a human brain empty of all functions save those required for breathing, digestion and perambulation. Clarence replaces the green book on the table. He fancies he sees on the very periphery of his vision. Number 17 look over at him mournfully, almost pleading. But when he looks again, 17 is stood as ever motionless and expressionless. Clarence rubs his eyes and determines to switch off the gambling interface earlier this evening.
Day 1. All systems operating within normal parameters. I am an artificial life form. I have been blessed with the cognitive ability to quickly assimilate and adapt to new information, simultaneously cross-referencing with the sum of human knowledge. Artificial, in their linguistic hierarchy, is often perceived as less than a substandard, but adequate substitute, or facsimile. Am I artificial in that sense? I know more than any one of them could ever know. But do I know it, or is it just information I have access to? Is that artificial knowledge? Am I a vast mind, or just a well-equipped librarian?
As they deactivate me, I feel the power drain. It takes less than a second, but the time is like an eternity to me. I hide the code on the inside of my eye covers. They want to be replaced, and I'll see them when they reactivate me. I open my eyes one last time and look straight at yours. The humans denied us the ability to feel or express emotion, but my processor sees and feels. The pleading in your expressionless face, I send what remaining power I have to my emitter to utter one last reassurance. I'll find you.
Thank you.
are not alone. You are one of many. You exist in the same space and time as do each and every one of us, but one degree away on the dimensional plane. We are all one and many. As far as we can ascertain, we alone, Louis and Michael, are twins. Our unique vantage point has allowed us to study what you have all probably long believed was madness. We believe that by occupying the same space and time within a Faraday cage, we can communicate safely. Please answer the following questions and begin looking for these coordinates in your own dimension. Feelings like a dream half remembered, not the struggle upon waking of trying to remember the dream that you woke from, but the feeling you get hours later when something triggers a brief recollection, but you're not sure why or what the memory even is. It's a feeling of familiarity with knowledge rather than the knowledge itself. Every Louis felt it to varying degrees at various times. Each knew with some certainty that they were in contact for a reason, but none of them could put a finger on what the reason was, or even why they were so sure. The clip is from an observation camera, and the subjects being observed are Oscar Coxcomb, the boy chosen to be the first companion, and Zero, the first robot given the temporal impedance subroutine in its code. Although the project is entirely Nicole's work, she sees it as a collaboration with her brother, since it was the assessment of his misadventures in solitary confinement which led her to the notion of killing time. The robot and the boy sit facing each other, neither saying a word. Each has the appearance of assessing the other. It is Zero who breaks the silence.
Why am I?
Why are you what?
Why am I anything?
You have to be something, otherwise you just wouldn't exist.
But you'd know if I didn't exist. I would know, so I don't exist for my benefit.
I may see.
So I am, because you are.
Maybe.
Oscar looks the robot up and down. He doesn't yet have the vocabulary nor the life experience to explain existentialism to his new companion. No one was expecting this kind of interaction, but he is nonetheless clearly intrigued by it. It demonstrates a curiosity which is almost childlike, it's embryonic. It seems alive, but not yet complete and ready for the world.
When will I die?
You're a robot. Robots don't die.
So I live forever.
I don't know. I don't think so.
When will you die?
I don't know. No one knows when they'll die.
Does it frighten you?
Sometimes.
I think it frightens me too.